غرباء 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 غرباء.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن نبينا وسيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، the title of today's lecture is The Perfume Seller or the Blacksmith. And that obviously denotes back to the famous hadith of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the authority of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, which is collected in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the example of a righteous companion and the example of an evil companion, like the example of the seller of musk and the blacksmith. As for the righteous companion, then he is like the seller of musk. Either you will buy the musk from him, or he will give you some musk to try on, or at the very least you will leave with a beautiful smell filling your senses. And the blacksmith is the one who will either burn your clothes, or he will burn a part of your body, or at the very least he will blacken your clothes, or you will leave with a foul stench. And so this is a very famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the title of this lecture has been taken from that hadith. So how do we choose our friends? What is the criteria and the basis that we use to choose our friends? And if you think about this and the way we normally live our lives, we're normally people that put in a lot of thought to things which sometimes aren't very important, right? So for example, when someone wants to buy a car, people will go and they will search so many websites, they will look at so many comparative models, the prices, the specs, what they get, what they don't get, how much insurance will cost, the tax price, and so on. And they'll compare all of this simply to buy a car, or to buy a TV, or to buy a computer. And we put in a lot of time, a lot of thought, and a lot of effort. So how do we choose our friends? Do we put in the same time and effort? Do we take the same time to look into and analyze who we're going to be friends with or who we're not? For the vast majority of us, our friends is a very natural process. It's like almost an evolutionary process. Most of us probably went to school, there were people in our class or in the same year or in the same school that we got to know, we grew up with them and they became our friends, whether good or bad. We didn't really think, are these people good for us? Are they bad for us? Are they going to increase us in Islam, decrease us in our Iman? They just became our friends and we moved on with them. Or we went to work and at the same time we have colleagues at work that we became friends with. Some people we became closer to over others and so they became our friends. Maybe others from amongst us have relatives and cousins at the same age, or people who are living on our streets, our neighbors who are around our age group. And so we would hang around with them, play football with them, play on the PlayStation with them and so on. And then we kind of grew up with them as well. And so it's a natural process. We never once stop to think, is he a good friend? Is he a bad friend? What kind of an influence do they have over us? But we just accepted them and we moved on for good or for bad. And that's how most of us have our friendships. That's how most of us have our friends and that's how we live our lives. Whereas if you look in Islam and you look in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as well as some of the verses in the Quran, you find that Allah Azza wa Jal and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do not encourage this natural selection process of friends. This evolutionary kind of process of just gaining a friend and then it just happening naturally. But rather it emphasizes that you choose your friends wisely. You look at those people around you. Who is beneficial for you? Who will increase you in your Iman? Who will bring you closer to the worship of Allah? And then you choose those individuals as your friends. And as for those people who don't do that, people who are probably neutral, they're neither good nor bad, they're your acquaintances. People that maybe you'll spend some time with, but they're not really your close circle of friends. And then you have that third category, people who are a bad influence on you. People who, when you spend time with, all they'll do is make sure you sin, backbite, lie, cheat, and so on. They're a bad influence on you. They decrease your iman. And so those are the people that you should avoid. And there are many examples of this throughout the Quran and the Sunnah. Examples of Allah stressing the importance of having good friends. Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in Surah Az-Zukhruf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الْأَخِلَّاءُ يَوْمَئِذٍ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌ إِلَّا الْمُتَّقِينَ. That on Yawm al-Qiyamah, the best of friends will come. And Allah uses the term Khalil, which in the Arabic language is your closest friend. That person who is closest to you, that person that you spend all of your time with, the person who, when you have good news or bad news, he's one of the first people that you will tell. The person that you travel with, that you sit with, that you speak to probably more or less every single day, or you see more or less every single day. That person or those individuals that are your closest friends. And all of us have people who are closer to us than others. These people are known as Khalil, or in Arabic the plural is Al-Akhilla. So Allah speaks about them on Yawm Al-Qiyamah, on this day when people will flee from one another. The mother and the father from their children, the husband from his wife and so on, the brother from his sister and so on. What will the friends do? Al-Akhilla'u yawma'idhim ba'duhum li ba'din adu. The closest of friends on that day will be enemies one to another. Illa al-muttaqin, except for those who have piety, except for those who possess taqwa. So everyone will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah, and those closest of friends will be enemies one to another. Why? Because they didn't increase one another in iman. They didn't bring one another closer to Allah. And so one will blame the other. Oh Allah, it's because of him, his influence over me, that I didn't worship you, that I didn't increase in iman, that I didn't come closer to you. It's because of him that I sinned, that I disobeyed, and so on. And the other one will repeat the accusation. Except for those who have taqwa, those who base their friendship on piety, on iman, on fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-Furqan, Allah Azza wa Jal again speaks about friendship. And it's amazing because the Quran speaks about the most important concepts that we need in our lives. And as humans, we are people who need to interact. We're a species who can't just live alone and seclude ourselves from everyone around us. We need to have interactions. And so the Quran speaks about important interactions. It speaks about the rights of parents and the rights of spouses and even the rights of the guest and neighbors. And the Quran also speaks about friendship because of its importance. Because Islam is a practical religion. Allah knows that we have friends, that we will have friends, that we will have these people around us, that we use their company in order to make our lives more pleasant, more easier, more bearable. And so likewise, Islam will give us guidelines for them. In Surah Al-Furqan, Allah Azza wa Jal again speaks about Yawm Al-Qiyamah. When on that day a person will come, وَيَوْمَ يَعَدُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ. On the day when a person, an individual will come and they will bite and chew on their own hands. Why is a person biting on their hands on Yawm Al-Qiyamah? Why are they chewing their own flesh on Yawm Al-Qiyamah? It's because of the remorse and the regret that they feel. And why do they feel regret and remorse? وَيَوْمَ يَعَدُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِ اتَّخَذْتُ مَعَ الرَّسُولِ سَبِيلًا. Because those people will be remorseful and regretful, and they will be saying, woe to me. If only I had taken the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his path as my way. If only I had followed his way. If only I had followed his sunnah. And that is in everything, not just in worship, but in the way I chose my friends, in the way I treated others, in the way that I dealt with my fellow brothers and sisters, in the way that I looked after the rights and the duties of those around me. If only I had taken his way. That's the first regret, the first remorse, not following our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What is the second remorse and regret? Ya waylata laytani lam attakhidh fulanan khalila. Woe to me if only I had not taken so-and-so as my closest friend. Subhanallah, how Allah combines between these two remorses. On the one hand, following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and on the other hand, taking someone else as a friend. Because that friend will determine your relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, your relationship with Allah and with the Quran, whether you're close or whether you're removed and distant. And so this person will regret taking that person as his closest friend. لَقَدْ أَضَلَّنِي عَنِ الذِّكْرِ بَعْدَ إِذْ جَاءَنِي. He was the one who misguided me from the remembrance of Allah after it came to me. He was the one who, when the time for prayer would come, he would invite me to go and do something else. Play football, watch a movie, waste our time. He was the one who, instead of encouraging me to go and perform Hajj, to go and take holiday somewhere else. He was the one who misguided me after I knew my duties as a Muslim. لَقَدْ أَضَلَّنِي عَنِ الذِّكْرِ بَعْدَ إِذْ جَاءَنِي وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِلْإِنسَانِ خَذُولًا. And indeed, shaitan is ever humiliating mankind. And subhanAllah, how shaitan doesn't rest. He won't leave a single avenue by which he can misguide you except that he'll use it. That closest person to you in your life, that closest friend who after your most immediate family is the closest person that you probably know and have. He is the one that you feel secure with. He is the one that you know that if you probably get into a fight, he'll be there for you. If you get into financial difficulty, he'll be there to support you. He'll probably sacrifice his life for you. So you feel safe and content and peaceful and secure in his presence. But shaitan will use that individual that you feel so safe with to be the means of your destruction. How shaitan continuously and consistently humiliates mankind. How he's always looking for ways to attack you from places that you can never imagine. And so Allah Azza wa Jal speaks about this in the Quran over and over again. And it is reported that the reason why these verses were revealed in the Quran, or one of the reasons why these verses were revealed in the Quran about friendship, was because of two individuals that lived at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Two men from the noblemen of Quraysh. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, at the beginning of Islam, he lived in Mecca. There were two men, one by the name of Umayyah ibn Khalaf, and the other one by the name of Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'id. Two men from the noblemen of Quraysh, both of them non-Muslims, both of them leaders of their people. People who were respected and honored amongst the Quraysh. As for Uqba ibn Abi Mu'it, one of those two, it was his practice that he would go and listen to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He wasn't a Muslim. He didn't believe in Islam. But he simply would like to go and listen to the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because even the Quraysh and the Arabs could not deny the eloquence and the beauty and the miraculous nature of the Quran. And so they would love to hear these words. So he would spend much time with him. He wasn't a Muslim, nor did he want to accept Islam, but he loved his company. And he loved to hear these words. Umayyah ibn Khalaf was his best friend, this other nobleman of Quraysh. They were best friends together. One day Umayyah ibn Khalaf, the man who didn't listen to the Prophet ﷺ, he came to the other leaders of Quraysh, the leaders of the other clans of Quraysh. And they began to make fun of him and mock him. And they said to him that your best friend, Uqba, has gone mad. He's been bewitched by that man Muhammad. And that's why he must go and sit with him every single day. He can't stay away, he's bewitched, he's mad. And his bewitchment, his madness, it will contagiate you as well. It is contagious. It will infect you as well. And you too will be afflicted. And so they began to make fun of him. Began to mock him and his friend. And this is what best friends do for one another. They feel for one another. When your best friend is attacked, you feel for that person because he's the closest person to you. So Umayyah ibn Khalaf, he took this as a personal attack upon him. Even though he never sat with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in fact, he was one of his most archest enemies. He was one of his most severe enemies. But he took it an attack upon himself. And so he went to his friend, Uqba, and he said to him, I swear by Allah that my face is haram for your face, meaning that we can never see one another again, unless you go and you spit in the face of Muhammad. Wal-iyadhu billah. Look at how he wants to preserve his own honor and the honor of his friend. Show these people of Quraysh that you're not bewitched, that you're not mad, that you haven't been overcome and possessed by his words. Go and spit in his face. Dishonor and humiliate him. And so Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt had a choice. The choice is either you don't spit in his face, the face of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but you lose your closest friend. Your closest friend, that person that is the closest to you. Maybe you've known him for 20, 30 years. You risk losing him. Or you do what he wants you to do. You spit in the face of that man and you bring your friend closer. It is a choice that a person makes. And so Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt, the next time he came and he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he spat in his face. Wal-iyadhu billah. And look at how his friendship influenced him. From listening and being mesmerized by the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he went to humiliating him in such a way, spitting in the face of our noble and beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him that you and your friend Umayyah, both of you will be in the fire. And both of them died on the day of Badr. Both of them were killed by the Muslims. Look at how these people in this dunya, because of their friendship, not only did they disbelieve in Allah, but they died in that state and they will be for eternity in hellfire. These are the people and people like them who will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And even though they went to such lengths in this world to protect and support one another, on that day there will be enemies one to another. They will be fighting one to another. They will be blaming one against the other. And so this is what these verses refer to. People like them that have this bondship, this friendship, this companionship, which isn't based upon Islam and Iman. It's not based upon taqwa, but it's based upon the dunya. And so my dear brothers and sisters, how do we choose our friends? What is the criteria that we use to choose our friends? What kind of an influence are our friends upon us? And what kind of an influence are we upon our friends? Because we can't just expect to choose our friends and for them not to choose us. It's a two-way process. How do you influence your friends? And how do they influence you? It was reported by Abu Idris al-Khawlani, rahimahullah, one of the great scholars of the Tabi'een. He said that I went to Damascus and I entered upon the mosque, the main mosque of Damascus. And I went to the people and I saw that all of them were gathering around a single young man. Everyone would go and stand around him. They would go and ask him questions. They would go and settle their disputes. Any issue that they would have, they would converge upon this man. So I went to someone and I said, who is this man that everyone seems to go to? So he said to me that this is the great companion of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, radiyallahu an, the great companion, the scholar of the companions. And so the man said, Abu Idris al-Khawlani, that when I saw him, I loved him for the sake of Allah. And I wanted to tell him that I love him for the sake of Allah. So I thought to myself that I will come tomorrow and I will be the first person to enter into the masjid before anyone else. And I will go to this companion and I will tell him what I feel. And so I went the next day and I entered into the masjid at a time that I thought that no one would be there before me. But I found that Mu'adh was already there praying. He was already in the masjid praying. So I waited for him to finish praying. And then I went to him and I said, O Mu'adh, inni uhibbuka fillah. Indeed, I love you for the sake of Allah. So Mu'adh looked at me and he said, Allah, do you swear by Allah that you love me for the sake of Allah? What an answer to this question. When someone comes to you, this statement, and they say that I love you for the sake of Allah, you say Jazakallah khair. Or you make the dua that the Prophet ﷺ said, may Allah love you just as you love me. But Mu'adh said, Allah, do you swear by Allah that you love me for the sake of Allah? So he said, yes. And then a second time Mu'adh said, Allah, do you swear by Allah that you love me for the sake of Allah? And again the man replied, yes. And then a third time Mu'adh again said, Allah, do you swear by Allah that you love me for the sake of Allah? And again the man replied, yes. And then Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu said, then have glad tidings, because I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, وَجَبَتْ مَحَبَّتِي فِي الْمُتَحَابِّينَ فِي وَالْمُتَجَالِسِينَ فِي وَالْمُتَزَاوِرِينَ فِي وَالْمُتَبَاذِلِينَ فِي. Four types of people, Allah's love is obligatory upon them. Allah Himself says that my love is obligatory upon these four types of people. And all of them are based upon friendship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that my love is incumbent upon those who love one another for my sake, and those who sit with one another for my sake, and those who visit one another for my sake, and those who strive for one another for my sake. What a beautiful hadith. Allah will love those who love one another for the sake of Allah, who sit and visit and strive for one another for the sake of Allah. And this is the criteria of friendship that we have in Islam. That we have in Islam. And the condition that is the most important condition within this hadith is that it is for the sake of Allah. Because everything you do with this Khalil, with this closest friend, your main option or your main goal and objective from this should be to increase in Iman, to bring you closer to Allah, that it is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this doesn't mean that you can't chill out with your friends, that you can't go out with a meal, that every time you sit you have to open Sahih al-Bukhari. This isn't what it means, nor is it something which the companions did. But the main objective is always that they will bring you closer to Allah. That even if you are just going to sit with them, to spend some rest time with them, then you do it for the sake of Allah. Because you love that person for the sake of Allah. And you know that when that person is depressed, when they're feeling down, when they have some problems in their lives, or you have some problems in your life, then you will be a support one to another. You will support each other. You will encourage one another. You will remind one another of Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And that's why you see that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu an, he would gather the companions around him, his people, and he would say, "Ijlis bina nazdadu imanan sa'a." Why don't you sit with us? Let us increase in iman for a short period of time. This was their goal. This was their objective. And you only need to look at the friendship and the companionship of Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhuma to see the fruit of such a companionship, the fruit of friendship which is based upon taqwa. And there are many stories of this from the life of the companions radiallahu anhum wardahum. It is reported by Al-Imam Al-Waqidi rahimahullah, who was a scholar of Islam after the time of the companions. He said that I had two friends who were very close to me. We would always go and travel with one another, but we lived a distance away from one another. We lived slightly far from each other, but we were close friends. So Imam Al-Waqidi says that a period of time came in my life when I became very poor. I became very poor and I didn't have much money. And I had a wife, I had children, but I didn't have much money to support them. And the month of Ramadan was upon us and Eid was around the corner. So my wife said to me that I feel embarrassed that on the day of Eid, all of our friends, our neighbors, our family members, they will wear new clothes and their children will dress in new clothes. But because of our financial situation, we can't afford any for our children. And it grieves me, it saddens me, right? Like any parent, if on the day of Eid, everyone else in the community, all of your friends are wearing new clothes and your children are still wearing last year's clothes, you'd feel sad. You'd want them to be equal with everyone else. You'd feel sorry for them. And so she felt the same way. So she said, why don't you ask one of your friends for some money? Ask him for some money. And so Al-Imam Al-Waqidi, he asked his friend, one of the two friends, he asked him for some money. And so that scholar or that person, that second friend, he sent him 1,000 dinar. In a bag, he sent it to him, 1,000 dinar. So Imam Al-Waqidi received this bag of 1,000 dinars. And as he received it, he received at the same time a letter from his third friend, from the third one, asking him also for money. He too was in a dire situation. He too was in need of help. And so he also asked him for money. So Imam Al-Waqidi has a choice. He's just taken out a loan. He's taken some money from a friend so that he can give it to his family, clothe his children, celebrate Eid with the Muslims. And on the other hand, his friend also requires this money. And so he also is in need. So now this is a choice. And look at the friendship that is based upon taqwa. And so he decided to give the money to his friend. What a difficult decision that must have been. He decided to give it all to his friend. And he went to his wife. In fact, he says in the narration that I felt so embarrassed that I slept that night in the masjid. I slept the night in the masjid. I couldn't go home and face my wife and my children. So I stayed in the masjid and I slept there. And then the next day I went home and I told my wife what took place. And my wife smiled at me and she became happy. And she said, I'm glad that you helped your friend and you gave him priority over us. Because you did a good deed. This is something which you did for the sake of Allah. I'd rather you have done that. And look at how the support of his family helps him. As he did this, his friend that loaned him the money, the person that gave him the 1,000 dinars, came and knocked on his door. He opened the door. And he said to him, that I want to know what you did with my money. Imam Al-Waqidi said, why does it matter? What does it matter what I did with your money? You gave it to me and I spent it in a way. He said, no, you have to tell me. So Imam Al-Waqidi said, okay, I'll tell you what happened. You gave me the money and then our third friend, he asked for the money, so I gave it to him. I gave him the money. And so Imam Al-Waqidi said, subhanallah, that money that I gave you, I now have it in my possession. And he took out the bag of 1,000 dinars. Imam Al-Waqidi said, how did you get your money back? He said, when you asked me for the money, I gave you everything that I had. 1,000 dinars was all that I had saved. I gave it to you. But then now I was in need. So I thought I would ask my other friend to now loan me some money. So I asked him and I asked him, can you borrow me some money? He didn't have any money, so he wanted you to give him some money. And so each one is asking the other for that same pot of money. And so it goes from Imam Al-Waqidi back to his third friend, who then gives it back to his other friend. And so it goes back to its owner. And so what they decided to do, because all three of them were in need, was that they would split it three ways. And so each one of them took a third. The Khalifa of the time, who was an Abbasi Khalifa, he heard of this story. So he called them all together. And he told them to come to the palace. And he said, I heard a story about you which amazes me at your friendship for one another. Tell me about it. So Imam Al-Waqidi says, I told him my story. And then the Khalifa of the Muslims, he said, by Allah, it is a testament for your love for one another. And so he said to them that I will give you each 1,000 dinars from me as a gift. I will give you each 1,000 dinars from me. And so each one of them left with an extra 1,000 dinars. Look at how the scholars and the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is reported by Umar radiallahu anhu that when Abu Bakr first became the Khalifa of the Muslims, he became the Khalifa of the Muslims at a time when there were many issues in the Muslim Ummah, many difficulties which had arisen. The Romans and the Persians were fighting the Muslims, people refused to pay the zakah, other Muslims had apostated from Islam, there were other men who claimed to be prophets after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, many issues afflicting the Ummah. So Umar came to Abu Bakr one day and he said, O Khalifa of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I know that you're busy with the affairs of the Muslims. I know that you're very busy. So why don't you make me and appoint me as your judge in Medina? Any issue that takes place amongst the Muslims of Medina, they come to me and I will settle their disputes. And as for you, you deal with the Ummah in general. Forget about Medina. So Abu Bakr agreed. And so for a year, Umar remained as the judge of Medina. After 1 year, one day he came back, after a year had passed, and he said to Abu Bakr, "Oh Abu Bakr, I want to resign. I want to resign." Abu Bakr was amazed. Umar doesn't resign, he makes others resign, but he doesn't resign. And so he said to him, Oh Umar, is it because of the difficulty of the burden that you carry? The responsibility that you bear upon your shoulders, being a judge isn't easy. To judge between people, it's a difficult job. Is it because of this burden that you want to resign? He said, "No, wallahi, no by Allah. But for the whole year that I have been a judge, not a single dispute has come before me. No two people have raised an issue before me. Every single one of them, this Muslim community that we have, every single one of them knows the rights that they have for one another. They know the rights that others have upon them, so they don't fall short in fulfilling their duty. They know the rights that they have upon others, so they don't ask for more than that. They know the rights of one another. If one of them is sick, they will visit him. If he needs financial help, they will support him. If one of them dies, they will shroud him and wash him, and they will bury him and pray his janazah. They are a community. They love one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abu Bakr, I don't want to resign because it's difficult. I want to resign because there's no need for me. You don't need a judge in Medina. The Muslims of Medina don't need anything. Subhanallah, what a beautiful society to live in. What a beautiful community to be a part of. And that doesn't mean that the companions and the Muslims at that time never differed. They were humans. They must have had differences. They must have had issues amongst themselves. But because they knew their rights and the rights of others, because they loved one another for the sake of Allah, they could settle them amongst themselves. They didn't need to go to Umar as the judge or Abu Bakr as the Khalifa or to appoint someone else. They knew their place. And so they would help one another. And when you look at the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the verses of the Quran that I have mentioned to you, then you begin to understand and put into perspective the hadith that I narrated to you at the beginning of the perfume seller and the blacksmith, and the other hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, al-mar'u ala dini khalilih falyanzur ahadukum man yukhalil. Each one of you is on the religion of his best friend, so choose your best friend wisely. Each one of you is on the religion of your closest friend, choose him wisely. And then you understand also the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he spoke about those seven types of people who on Yawm al-Qiyamah will be given the shade of Allah on the day that there will be no shade except the shade of Allah. And from those seven is rajulani tahabba fillah ijtama'a alayhi wa tafarraqa alayhi. Two men, two individuals, two people who love one another for the sake of Allah. If they meet, they meet because they love one another. And if they depart, they depart upon this love. And why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give them this beautiful and praiseworthy reward on Yawm al-Qiyamah? Because of their love for one another. Because it's based upon taqwa. And when you look at the companions, this was what their religion was based upon. Their friendship, their companionship, their religion was based upon taqwa. Their friendship to one another was because of taqwa. So my dear brothers and sisters, in conclusion, I return to the question that I asked you at the beginning. How do we choose our friends? What is the criteria that we lay out for our friends? What influence do we have on our friends and our friends have upon us? This is something which we need to ponder over and reflect. And we need to surround ourselves. We need to surround ourselves with companions and friends that will increase us in iman, that will encourage us to worship Allah better, to learn more about this religion, to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once we do this and we achieve this, we will find much more blessing in our lives. We will find that it is easy for us to worship Allah, that when we go down, we become depressed and sad, they will raise our spirits and strengthen our iman. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, remember that some of the greatest rewards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give to a person is because of their love for one another. Loving one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah azza wa jal grant us companions and friends that are true, that are based upon taqwa, companions and friends that increase us in iman, that bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and may He resurrect us all under the shade and the flag of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on yawm al-qiyamah, and may He enter us into jannatul firdaus al-a'la. Hatha wallahu a'lam wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
غرباء 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 غرباء